Cooler Master is an expert in cooling solutions, so I am eager to check out the first passively cooled unit, the X-Silent Edge. This PSU promises high performance and insane power levels for a passive PSU. It uses an in-house platform, and according to Cooler Master, everything is made by its own production lines, including the chassis, all relevant cooling parts and the PCB. So far, users who wanted a strong, at the same time dead silent PSU didn't have any options, especially if they also wanted an ATX version 3.1 compliant unit. This changes with the X-Silent Edge model, which uses a specially designed chassis with an embedded cooling solution to remove the heat from the PSU's internals. This advanced cooling system allows for increased power levels without the need for forced cooling. Key features: fanless design, advanced heat pipe technology, digital monitoring, features a digital monitor for real-time temperature and load tracking, high-quality components, master control software integration, allows users to monitor and manage PSU parameters from their desktops. Energy efficiency incorporates an active bridge rectifier for improved efficiency and performance. The PSU didn't come in its detail box, but in a plain one, so to not leave this area empty, here's a photo of me buying a new tool for the lab. I could probably use this tool to dismantle PSUs. This is a passive PSU, so there is no fan at its top side. The top side is full of perforations to allow the air to flow freely outside the PSU. Moreover, the PSU's bottom side is actually a massive heatsink featuring heat pipes, as you will see in the path analysis section, which cool down the FETs regulating the 12-volt rail. The PSU's modular panel hosts 16 sockets, including a native 12-volt 2x6. Three of these sockets are for the USB interface, the PM bus, and for connecting a fan. The ATX cable is 645 mm long, the EPS cables are the same length, and all PCIe legacy cables are a bit shorter at 550 mm. The high power PCI Express cable is longer at 650 mm. The number of peripheral connectors is sufficient, but the distance between the 4-pin Molex connectors is short at 120 mm. While it is sufficient for the SATA connectors at 140 mm. All cables are individually sleeved and dark painted to be stealthy inside the dark chassis interior. Performing path analysis on this platform was not easy because the huge heatsinks obscured most parts' views. Removing the beefy heatsinks without destroying the PCB or some sensitive parts is daunting, so we did everything we could without removing them. Thankfully, the PCB is large enough, providing enough space for airflow and for the interested reviewers to poke around and identify parts. The platform's design is clean and interesting, and the large heatsinks covering most parts are necessary since there is no forced cooling. The secondary side is clear and only has a pair of electrolytic capacitors, leaving ripple filtering to polymer caps tolerant to high operating temperatures. Cooler Master paid special attention to the cooling of the PFC's choke and of the main transformer, since inductor core saturation depends on the operating temperature. You don't want any of these two to saturate, since when this happens, the inductors will be greatly reduced and the ability to suppress the current is lost. In other words, when an inductor is saturated, it doesn't behave as an inductor, but as a small resistor because of the conductor's resistance. And this can create a fatal short circuit, which will blow the FETs before the inductor. The build and soldering quality are impeccable, and Cooler Master's PSU production line seems to be top-notch. A bridgeless PFC converter, a full bridge topology, and an LNC resonant converter are used on the primary side, a synchronous scheme is used on the secondary side, and two DC-DC converters generate the minor rails. A weird thing in this PSU is that although it has two MCUs, which could handle the entire primary side and the part of the secondary side, still analog controllers are utilized to control the APFC, the main and the 12-volt FETs, and the minor rails. Normally, the digital controllers should control the APFC converter, the main and 12-volt FETs, but they could also handle the fetch regulating the minor rails. Still, special firmware is required for this, and it seems Cooler Master is not ready yet to provide this firmware. So, unfortunately, the MCUs are only used for communicating purposes between the PSU and the system and for some sensor readings. The PSU's cost could come down if the MCUs were omitted from the moment the PSU's vital functions rely on analog controllers. Hopefully, Cooler Master will improve the design and get rid of the analog controllers instead, and further improving performance and lowering the production cost. At the PCB's solder side, we find all FETs regulating the 12-volt rail, which are cooled down by the PSU's chassis, which incorporates a strong cooling solution with 4 heat pipes and a block. Since this is a passively cooled PSU, the OCP and OPP triggering points are relatively low set to protect it from abuse. I would like to see a larger difference between the 12-volt OCP's triggering points and the OPP ones between hot and cold conditions. Load regulation is tight at 12-volt, but it could be tighter on the minor rails, especially at 3.3-volt. Ripple suppression is good. The transient response is great at 12-volt, good at 5 VSB, and mediocre at 5-volt and 3.3-volt. The PSU passes all ATX version 3.1 transient response tests. While the 12-volt rail performs well in the normal transient response tests, it doesn't do so well in the ATX version 3.1 corresponding tests, especially in the 200% test where it drops too low. Efficiency at normal loads is sky high, but exactly the opposite is the case at light loads. The platform's average efficiency is high, the FFC converter performs well, the 5 VSB rail is highly efficient, setting new standards for this rail, vampire power is increased, the unit's efficiency exceeds 94% for most of its operation map. Thanks to the sky-high efficiency, the thermal loads remain low, so the PSU's passive cooling system can easily handle them. The overall performance is top. The Cooler Master X Silent Edge 1100 is an interesting product. It is the strongest passively cooled PSU available on the market today. Thanks to an advanced cooling system with heat pipes that its chassis incorporates, this PSU is entirely made by Cooler Master's team, both design and production, and this is impressive given that it is not as easy as it sounds to design your own PSU platform and also build it. The design is weird though, to say the least. Given the pair of FGUs that I found at its internals, I expected a semi-digital design, the least, but I found instead analog controllers in every vital circuit. Having the digital controllers in place doesn't say much if you don't have the corresponding firmware, and this is Cooler Master's next goal, to fully utilize these controllers. However, from the moment they are not utilized fully in this PSU, they could be omitted, vastly lowering the production cost. Although the X-Silent Edge achieves a top overall score, it feels to me that it is an intermediate stage to something great. Without any doubt, Cooler Master needs to work in this field to gain more experience, and this PSU is a stage towards the ultimate goal, which is to release a fully digital PSU. Other experienced OEMs didn't even manage or simply didn't want to make this step, but Cooler Master did that, and I respect its team for that. Back to the X-Silent Edge, it's called top performance in some areas. Still, some performance factors need improvement, including the load regulation on the minor rails, efficiency at light and super light loads, and especially the 12-volt rails transient response in ATX version 3.1 scenarios, which are the toughest ones. Lower vampire power at 230-volt would be good too. During all test sessions, we didn't encounter any coil whine issues, which are usually a major headache in passive PSUs where there is no fan noise to cover them. The X Silent Edge performed amazingly well in this section, and since we always need dead silent PSUs for our hemianechoic chamber, it will probably replace the ones we currently use. If you are wondering, I didn't test the PSU at 115 volt because its max power drops to 850 watt, which is still higher than everything available in the passive PSU market today. It would be a pain to have graphs of above 1000 watt and 850 watt units at the same time. It would be like two separate reviews in one, leading to confusion in the end. The Cooler Master X-Silent Edge 1100 is not affordable. It currently costs $400, while its normal price is $510. The X-Silent Max 1300, which is not fully passive, is more affordable at $459. The fact is that passive units are typically way more expensive than normal ones because of the technology involved and the RMA risk. Cooler Master also made a move that I don't agree with, providing a crazy long 15-year warranty to these units. I hope this doesn't backfire on Cooler Master. The Cooler Master X-Silent Edge 1100 is the best performing passively cooled PSU, meeting eye-to-eye units with active cooling. On top of that, it is by far the strongest passive unit available in today's market. Yes, it needs further development and improvements in various sectors, and above all, it needs to get rid of all analog controllers and fully explore its pair of MCUs. Still, I believe it will be wrong if I do not give it an editor's choice. I'm very strict with editor choice awards. I only provide this award on special occasions, and this is one of them. I hope Cooler Master continues the development of this platform and seriously considers my comments to improve it. It should also drop the ridiculously long warranty period and provide something more down to earth. Before investing in a new power supply, read my best ATX version 3.x PSUs article on hardwarebusters.com to check all alternative PSU offerings. You can also find these products review on the same site. Bye bye.